Good afternoon, everyone. This is Brother Lloyd. Shabbat Shalom to all my Sabbath keepers out there. I hope you all having a wonderful and blessed day. Now, last week I did a teaching on Sunday and the Sabbath, which really was more of a history lesson for a Sunday keeper so that they know and understand why they do what they do, especially when all you know is what you've done and don't really ever think about where it came from and how you got there. So I just put that out there, and I'm sure it helped at least one Sabbath keeper to understand why Sunday keepers do what they do if they didn't know. But one thing I'm certainly aware of is that when I do teachings or lessons like this, that it's going to contradict what some people know and believe in their heart to be true, and it's always going to raise some type of controversy. But like I always say, the Father gives us free will to choose whatever course we will. We must all be fully persuaded in our own minds. But the thing to that is, I'm obligated to put the truth out there as I learn it or as I know it, as we all are. We are all obligated to put truth out there so people can be informed and do what they will with it. So with that to the side, today I'm going to do something that we all should know or know something about, and that's the commandments. We should all know the commandments, but I'm pretty certain that at least one of you really don't know the commandments. So first and foremost, understand that the Ten Commandments are really an encompassing summary of all the Father's law, all 600 plus of them. These 10 kind of encompass all of them, and then you can put them under whichever category they apply as you go along through life. But the bottom line is, he gave us a summary of all his laws and 10 so that we would understand. Now, what people really need to do or stop doing when it comes to the commandments, they need to stop trying to streamline and narrow what they say to justify or qualify things that they are doing that violate the Father's will. For instance, someone will say, where in the Bible does it say you can't wear wedding rings? Because I remember a while back I did a video about wedding rings, and of course that raises controversy because people love their rings and their jewelry and all these different things. So let's tackle that for a couple minutes. So go with me to Genesis 35:2, and this is the account of Jacob. 35:2 reads like this. It says, then Jacob said unto his household and to all that were with him, put away the strange gods that are among you, and cleanse yourselves, and change your garments. Now, why did Jacob, whose name was later changed to Israel, say this to his family and all those that he had brought out of his homeland with him? Well, obviously, there was something that wasn't acceptable. They were about to be in the presence of the Almighty himself, and they were not presentable, obviously, according to the Father's standards. So Jacob told them to do this. They had to come to him clean and sanctified. The reference for this takes you to Exodus 19, 10, and 11. And it reads, and the Lord said unto Moses, go unto the people and sanctify them today and tomorrow, and let them wash their clothes. Verse 11 reads, and be ready against the third day. For the third day, the Lord will come down in the sight of all the people upon Mount Sinai. Now, once again, as in Jacob's case, the people had to be clean and sanctified. Now, remember, Jacob and his people come from a background that's pagan, full of idolatry and false worship and idols and all these different things. Jacob's wife, Rachel, when she left her father's house, she stole his idols, all his little idols that he worshiped. She stole those and brought them with her on their journey. And Moses' people, on this same account, when they left Egypt, remember, they had just come out of bondage, and all these things that they had become accustomed to in Egypt, all the traditions, all the false worship and worshiping Egyptian gods, all the different styles of dress, the jewelry, the makeup, all these things come from the Egyptians. This is where the children of Israel picked up all this stuff from. This is what they knew. In case you don't remember, how did the Egyptians look and how did they dress? Okay, so go with me to Genesis 35 and verse 4 now. We're still talking about Jacob. And this verse reads, "And they gave unto Jacob all the strange gods which were in their hands, and all the earrings which were in their ears, and Jacob hid them under an oak, which was by Shechem." Jacob said, "Give me all these false gods, all these idols, all this jewelry, all this stuff." And obviously they knew. See, the bottom line, people, all that stuff rooted in pagan and Egyptian idolatry and worship, that's where it comes from. Wedding rings included. Look, no matter how you dress it up, it's all about worshiping false gods. I don't care what you call it. I don't care if you say it's about the children. I don't care if you say it's about this, that, or the other. You can disguise it however you want. But when you do these things, you're worshiping these idols and these false gods. And the father says it is not permissible. That's why we're going to read the commandments. Rings come from Egyptians, Romans, arguably the Greeks. Whoever, it comes from them. This is where the ring thing come from. And they use them for all sorts of things. And ultimately, it worked its way into modern day society to be engagement and betrothal rings and wedding rings and all that. You can disguise it and make it appear to not be what it is. And that's just what the enemy wants us to do with everything that he perverts that the Father says we shouldn't or should do. He creates a counterfeit. And people fall in line with it because they enjoy it, they love it, they like it, and it doesn't appear to them to be what it is. But I digress.
We are currently experiencing technical problems. Please sit by.
What I really want to do is make sure that you're all familiar with the commandments, because most people really aren't sure. They know a few of them, but they really don't know the commandments. And if you really don't know because you haven't studied, you're liable to do all sorts of things that you shouldn't be doing. And then when someone says something to you about it not being right, you will justify your behavior. Number one, "I am the Lord your God. You shall worship the Lord your God, and him only shall you serve. 2, you should not take the name of the Lord your God in vain. 3, remember to keep holy the Lord's day. 4, honor your father and your mother. 5, you shall not kill. 6, you should not commit adultery. 7, you should not steal. 8, you should not bear false witness against your neighbor. 9, you should not covet your neighbor's wife. And 10, you shall not covet your neighbor's goods." Now, I have a question. Is anyone fussing yet? At the least, someone should be sitting there going, "Huh? That doesn't sound quite right." Well, the reason it doesn't sound quite right to some is because
you can't handle the truth.
Those 10 that I just read are from the Catholics, from the Roman Catholic Church. Those are their version of the 10 Commandments. Let me say this. To some, it will sound perfectly okay because those are the 10 commandments that they have learned. Those are the 10 commandments that they know. And to them, they are correct. Now, the reason it doesn't sound right to some of us is because we know Exodus 20 and we know Deuteronomy. We know how they read. And it does sound a little odd. So what we're going to do is go through them and break them down. We're going to read, once again, the Catholic, but at the same time, we're going to read the Exodus version out of the King James. And then in the end, we're going to really discuss what's really going on here. So, number one, once again, the Catholic version. "I am the Lord your God. You shall not have strange gods before me." Now, Exodus 20 verses 2 and 3 read like this. "I am the Lord thy God, which have brought thee out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. Thou shalt have no other gods before me." Now, obviously, you notice there's some slight variance there, which I will get back to. Number two, "You shall not take the name of the Lord your God in vain." Exodus 20, verses 4 through 6 read, "Thou shalt not make unto thee any graven image or any likeness of anything that is in the heaven above, or that is in the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. Thou shalt not bow down thyself to them, nor serve them, for I, the Lord thy God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children unto the third and fourth generation of them that hate me, and showing mercy unto thousands of them that love me and keep my commandments." Wow, that's a mouthful, and that's just one commandment. Number three, remember to keep holy the Lord's day. That's the Catholic version. Exodus 20 and verse 7 reads, "Thou shalt not take the name of the Lord thy God in vain, for the Lord will not hold him guiltless that taketh his name in vain." Now, as you see here, as we go through the number sequencing, they're different now. And that's because there's been some adjustments within the Catholic version or the Roman Catholic Church version, which we will discuss. Number four reads, "Honor your father and your mother." Exodus 28 through 11 read like this. "Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days shalt thou labor and do all thy work, but the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord thy God. In it thou shalt not do any work, thou, nor thy son, nor thy daughter, thy manservant, nor thy maidservant, nor thy cattle, nor thy stranger that is within thy gates. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, the sea, and all that in them is, and rested the seventh day. Wherefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and hallowed it." That is the fourth commandment according to the King James Bible. Number five, "You shall not kill." Exodus 20 and verse 12 reads, "Honor thy father and thy mother, that thy days may be long upon the land which the Lord thy God giveth thee." Number six, "You shall not commit adultery." King James, Exodus 20 and verse 13 reads, "Thou shalt not kill." Number seven, "You shall not steal." Exodus 20:14 reads, "Thou shalt not commit adultery." You see the sequencing's off by one now. The Catholic version is one ahead of the actual King James Exodus version. Number eight, "You shall not bear false witness against your neighbor." Exodus 20:15 reads, "Thou shalt not steal." Number nine, "You shall not covet your neighbor's wife." Exodus 20:16 reads, "Thou shalt not bear false witness against thy neighbor." And number 10, "You shall not covet your neighbor's goods." Exodus 20 and verse 17 reads, "Thou shalt not covet thy neighbor's house. Thou shalt not covet thy neighbor's wife, nor his manservant, nor his maidservant, nor his ox, nor his donkey, nor anything that is thy neighbor's." Exodus 20 and verse 17 is just one scripture, and it covered all coveting. That's the bottom line. It says to not covet anything, people, property, everything. But if you notice real quickly, in the Catholic version, number 9 and 10 are both about coveting. So what they did was take Exodus 20:17, the coveting scripture, and broke it into two commandments. My question is, why did they do this? Because we still have to go back and find out what's wrong with their version of the commandments, not just the fact that they split one into two to make 10. So if they split one into two to make 10, something's missing, but we're going to get to that in 1 second. Now, I asked the question, why did they do this? Well, if we go back up to the second commandment, or the Catholic version of the second commandment, it reads, it says, "You should not take the name of the Lord your God in vain." But Exodus 20, verses 4 through 6, read like this, and pay attention. "Thou shalt not make unto thee any graven image or any likeness of anything that is in the heaven above, or that is in the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. Thou shalt not bow down thyself to them, nor serve them. For I, the Lord thy God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children unto the third and fourth generation of them that hate me, and showing mercy unto thousands of them that love me and keep my commandments." So this is what they hid by removing it: idolatry. The Roman Catholic Church, the papacy, look at it. It is full of idolatry. See, here's the deal. They know that idolatry is a serious violation of the Father's law. So they hid it, they removed it out of the commandments, and then turned right around and flaunted it in the face of the Almighty. Now, do you understand the wrath that is eventually going to fall upon them when the time comes? See, everyone who's in apostasy and in rebellion against the Father.
We are currently experiencing technical problems. Please sit by.
In the end, His wrath is going to be poured out on them and they will suffer to no end.
We are currently experiencing technical problems. Please sit by.
Accountability, people, I'm telling you, comes with knowledge and knowing right from wrong. If someone points out a glaring truth to you, you have a choice to make. But with that, the Father gives us free will.
Uh-oh.
Many will ignore the truth because that means something in their life has to change. But also understand, if you ignore something because you don't want to change, it's making a choice. You have chosen to not do anything. To not believe is making a choice, and so on and so on. Now, it never fails that someone will ask me about something that's written because I put it out there. Remember, it's the Father's word, not mine. I just put it out there. I'm obligated to do that. But someone will say, well, is this a salvation issue or is it a that issue? And my answer to that question is this, James 4:17. Therefore, to him that knoweth to do good and doeth it not, to him it is sin. So if we know something is right and we don't do it, it's sin. Yes, it's a salvation issue. If you willfully neglect and violate and choose to be in rebellion against the Father, you have to understand that it is a salvation issue. He is not going to allow sin into His kingdom. No one will carry sin into heaven. If you carry it into the grave with you, you will not be going to heaven. Because when He raises you, you will still have that sin on you. Remember, when probation closes, when He stands up and says, it is finished, we are what we are. Those who are filthy, they're going to stay filthy. Those who are righteous are going to stay righteous. Read scripture, people. Study. The problem is, people don't want to let go of the world and the things that they love and desire and care for so much. They are comfortable in whatever situation they are in. This is why we are constantly tried, because people have to constantly be proven to see if they are going to be overcomers and do what is right. We have to go through trials and we have to stand for the Father and overcome them. If we can't stand for the Father now, what makes you think that you will stand for Him when Daniel 12:1 happens? And that reads, and at that time, Michael shall stand up, the great prince which standeth for the children of thy people, and there shall be a time of trouble such as never was since there was a nation, even to that same time. And at that time, thy people shall be delivered, every one that shall be found written in the book. Now, if you cannot stand for the small things going on now and go through your trials and overcome them, what makes you think that you will stand and bear the time of trouble? The word says that that time of trouble shall be something that we have never seen. We can't imagine it. So think about that, people. Many of you really, really have no idea what's about to unfold in this country and around the world. If you can't stand for the Father against man's persecution and man's wrath and all the little things that He's doing now, persecuting believers because they won't accept all these different things into their lives and their businesses, what makes you think you're going to stand for Him when things really get tough? And with that, this is Brother Lloyd. I'm out.